problem. It is now time for a question period. The member from Leeds Grenville.
Thank you very much, Speaker. My question to the acting premier. On December 11th, a particular federal MP stood up to address the Canadian House of Commons and made statements like, "New Democrats have, New Democrats support, New Democrats also feel." Acting Premier, that was your new member from Sudbury. Those words were spoken on the afternoon of December 11th, the same afternoon the Premier claims to have told Andrew Olivier she was appointing Mr. Thibault. Acting Premier, if your Premier had already decided to appoint Mr. Thibault as the Liberal candidate on December 11th, do you really think it's appropriate that he was passing himself off as a New Democrat and he was collecting his federal paycheck until your operatives could sway Mr. Olivier with an alleged bribe?
Speaker, I have to say that Glenn Thibault is an excellent addition to our government. He is a very strong advocate for the people of Sudbury, and we welcome him here on the government side. Throughout his career, Glenn has shown an unwavering commitment to the people of Sudbury, Speaker. I've had a chance to speak to this before, and I will speak to it again. He has fought tirelessly for supports for persons with developmental disabilities, and I know that's an issue that's important to you and other members of your caucus. He's fought tirelessly for quality services for people, families struggling with autism. He was a director of the United Way. He led many successful campaigns in support of community development. He was a proud volunteer with Big Brothers Big Sisters, Speaker, and he coached minor hockey and football. He's helped empower Sudbury youth to achieve their full potential. We are delighted that Glenn Thibault has chosen the Liberal.
Thank you. The member from Renfrew-Nipissing-Pembroke will come to order. Supplementary.
To the acting premier. The premier said she made the decision to appoint Mr. Thibault
member for Beaches,
on November
East
30th. She allegedly told Mr. Olivier on December the 11th. Pat Sorbera offered Mr. Olivier an appointment to step aside on December 12th. Mr. Thibault made his announcement public December 17th. Confusingly enough, on December 17th, many residents in Sudbury opened their mailboxes to find a taxpayer-funded mail-out from the federal NDP member of Sudbury's parliamentary budget. Acting Premier, do you think it's appropriate for the member to send out a mailer if, as you claim, the Premier made the decision to appoint him in November?
Deputy Premier. I will be extremely tight in my expectation to bring attention when I stand. And if it continues, we'll get right straight to naming.
So let's speak about the track record of the member from Sudbury, Speaker. While he was in Ottawa, he advocated for greater retirement security, Speaker, enhanced consumer protection, and significant investments in the Ring of Fire. These are all issues and expertise he brings to Ontario. As an MPP, he's been appointed the Parliamentary Assistant to the Minister of the Environment and Climate Change, where he'll work on the defining issue of our generation, Speaker. Yesterday, he was in attendance at the Prospectors and Developers Association of Canada conference, advocating for Sudbury's mineral exploration and development industry. He is a very, very strong voice for Sudbury, and that's why the people of Sudbury sent him to Queen's Park.
Final supplementary.
Back again to the acting premier. If Mr. Thibault knew on November 30th that he was running for you, as the premier has said over and over and over again. And if that's true, it's absolutely unethical and abuse of his parliamentary budget and taxpayers' dollars to promote himself that close to stepping down and running at a different level. Acting Premier, do you support Mr. Thibault's use of taxpayers' money to promote himself if he was already your candidate?
Thank you. The member from Lanark will come to order. Deputy Premier.
You know, Speaker, this morning I had a little glimmer of hope that things were changing in the PC party, because the member from Whitby-Oshawa said, and let me quote her, she said, "For too long, our party has been out of touch with everyday Ontarians." I agree with the member from Whitby-Oshawa. She said, "For too long, we focused on identifying problems instead of providing solutions." I agree with the member from Whitby-Oshawa. And then she said, and this is what gave me hope, and this is what she said, "Well, that changes today. Today is a new day."
Order.
Today, all of us here, this team, we have a new attitude and a new plan, and I was hoping for new questions, Speaker.
Thank you.
New questions. Stop. Be seated, please. Be seated, please. Be seated, please.
I remind all members when I stand, everyone sits. And I also remind the government side that when I ask you to be seated, you are to be seated. New question. The Leader of Her Majesty's Royal Opposition.
Mr. Speaker, my question is for the Acting Premier. Yesterday, the government caucus voted against our motion asking for the simple recognition that the Premier's office must be above suspicion and a commitment that we preserve the integrity of Ontario's highest political office. It's shameful, Mr. Speaker, that the Liberal government continues to protect Liberal fundraiser Jerry Lougheed Jr. and the Premier's Deputy Chief of Staff, Pat Sobera, in the face of serious allegations that they offered bribes to convince someone not to run for office. Acting Premier, despite precedents and expectations that these individuals be stripped of their taxpayer-paid positions until the accusations are resolved, you and your government and your Premier continue to refuse to take the honourable and right action. Your refusal to even acknowledge the dark cloud cast on democracy begs the question, what are you trying to hide?
Deputy Premier.
Well, Speaker, the Premier and our entire caucus take this, this matter very seriously, and the Premier has spoken to that repeatedly. The investigation is independent of this House. The investigation is being conducted by competent people who actually know how to conduct investigations, Speaker. Elections Ontario determined that the allegations against the Premier and the member from Sudbury were baseless. However, we will continue to cooperate fully, Speaker. I actually agree when the PC House Leader said, stop interfering in an ongoing investigation, let it run its course.
Oh, okay.
When asked about charges laid against PC staff member this week, the PC member from Whitby-Oshawa said, I really don't have a comment on this because it's before the courts. And even this morning,
answer,
when she was asked about that, she said, I'm leaving it in the hands of the police and the justice system to continue their investigation.
Thank you.
I'm confident they'll come to the...
Thank you. Supplementary.
Yeah, when something happens wrong on this side of the House, we suspend the member. The member steps aside. In this case, that staff member stepped aside. Why don't you learn? Why don't you learn for when I was Minister of Health, I stepped aside for 10 weeks when someone on my staff said something stupid to a Globe and Mail reporter. There was absolutely no accusation of criminal wrongdoing. There was no breach of the Elections Act. You've got an OPP officer that sworn an affidavit that you broke the law. You broke the law in trying to bribe Mr. Olivier. You've got the chief electoral officer going as far as he can.
Except that I'd ask the member to withdraw.
Withdraw.
Carry on.
Allegation that you broke the law. I think the OPP officer deserves some respect. She wouldn't have sworn out an affidavit if she didn't have reason to believe that the law has been breached. As ditto with the chief electoral officer. As you know, he has gone as far as he can in his powers, and he's recommending that the OPP look at this, and that's exactly what they're doing. Do the right thing. Step
Thank
aside.
You.
Tell us today you're going to do the right thing.
Be seated, please. Be seated, please. Thank you. Deputy Premier.
Well, Speaker, if we want to talk about the member's record, let's go back to 1998, Speaker, when former NDP MPP Floyd Loughran resigned his seat to become chair of the Ontario Energy Board. And let me quote from the Hamilton Spectator. Veteran MPP Floyd Logan, the former New Democrat finance minister, is calling it quits to accept a $120,000 a year government appointment. So who was energy minister? Who appointed?
Member from Barrie, come
None
to order.
Other than the current interim leader of the official opposition. So if we want to talk about your record, let's talk about your record, Speaker. To make it worse, the leader of the opposition was asked to explain how this could have happened, and his answer was, if you're looking for logic in this place, if you're looking for logic in this business, you're in the wrong place. Well, we are looking for logic,
answer.
And we are looking to let the investigation happen outside this House.
Thank you. Final supplementary.
Well, Mr. Speaker,
be seated, please. Be seated, please.
I would ask the member from Renfrew to let me do that job, whether they sit up or stand up or whatever. I'll do it. I'm not prepared to engage anyone in a conversation. Final supplementary.
Well, they mentioned the case of Floyd Logren. Back to the acting premier. I think you owe Mr. Logren an apology. The chronology in that case,
Deputy House Logren
had stepped down from office. He was eminently qualified to be chair of the Ontario Energy Board, and he was appointed some months later after he stepped down from office and voluntarily left this place. You owe him an apology.
I think so.
And I hate to admit it, but he actually did a really good job as chair of the Ontario Energy Board, and we were all very proud of him, even though he wasn't much of a treasurer. So, when Greg Sabara stepped down, for it just simply being named in a affidavit, in a warrant, he said this: a rather serious mistake is being made, but the interests of our government are greater than the interests of my personal career as finance minister.
Yeah.
Now, I didn't always agree with Mr. Sabara, but that's a class act. Why don't you show some class?
Thank you.
Dismiss these individuals.
Thank you. Be seated, please. Be seated, please. Thank you. Deputy Premier.
Well, Speaker, perhaps you could turn around and speak to the woman behind you, the member from Kawartha Lakes Brock, who resigned her seat in 2009 and accepted a paid position on the same day. Sudbury Star reported Scott trade seat for head office job. The Sudbury Star says PC Laurie Scott was given the job Friday of getting the opposition ready for the next election in exchange for giving her seat in giving up her seat in the Ontario legislature. So we have no idea who had conversations with whom. She may very well have stepped down voluntarily, but would she have been willing to do that without?
The member from Leeds-Grenville, the member from Renfrew-Nipissing-Pembroke, and the member from Prince Edward-Hastings will come to order. Second time.
So, Speaker, I know we can't always trust PC math, but we've seen the numbers, and we wonder who's stepping down for Patrick Brown.
Order. Order. New question, the Leader of the Third Party.
Thank you, Speaker. My question is for the Deputy Premier. The Liberals are trying to rewrite history. Yesterday, the Premier insisted it was common knowledge that she was going to appoint Glenn Thibault in November. Horse feather, Speaker. On December 12th, Jerry Lougheed said to Andrew Olivier, and I quote, "The Premier up to now has always said to me she's in favour of nomination races, so I want to make that really clear. She's never said to me I'm going to appoint him, and to be fair to Glenn has never said to me I want to be appointed. Now, this isn't rhetoric, Speaker, or spin. It's the Premier's Liberal kingmaker on tape. When will the Liberals start telling the truth about the Sudbury bribery scandal?
Well, Speaker, as the Premier has said time and time and time again, she made the decision when she met Glenn Thibault, she made the decision that he was going to be the candidate. And you know what? She wasn't the only one who thought that Glenn Thibault would be an excellent candidate. Let me read the editorial from the Northern Life. This is what they had to say. We say elect Glenn Thibault. He's a seasoned politician with deep roots in the community whose skills put him head and shoulders above the other candidates. He's been a very effective constituency man, an articulate member of the opposition, and past executive of the United Way. Thibault will be working for the government in power. We believe he'll make a difference. Sudbury is the mining capital of the world. We need to be plugged into government to maximize our economic growth and sustainability. So it wasn't just the Premier who thought he'd be the best candidate, Speaker. The people of Sudbury made that decision.
Speaker, yesterday the Premier stood up and insisted that she's been answering questions for weeks. It's true, the Premier has stood up and she's talked, but she hasn't actually answered a single thing. This is a really important question, Speaker. There's no spin, there's nothing complicated, it isn't a trick question. The question is pretty straight up. Who told Pat Cerbera and Jerry Lougheed to offer Andrew Olivier a job? Jerry Lougheed says it was the Premier. I'm asking the Deputy Premier now, who was it?
Deputy Premier.
Speaker, the leader of the NDP knows full well that it's not appropriate to comment on a police investigation. In fact, on December 11th last year, the leader of the NDP held a press conference at the media studio right here at Queen's Park. She was questioned then on criminal allegations against an NDP candidate. Allow me to read to you what the leader of the third party said during this press conference. Right now, this is a matter that's in front of the police. I can't talk about the details at this point because police are investigating. The member was asked question after question, many by Richard Brennan, but refused to answer. She was asked 14 times. And then what did she say? She said, I'm not going to talk about this any longer. I've said to you what I need to say. The police are investigating the matter. So the NDP keep asking week after week questions about matter before the police. I think the leader.
Thank you. Final supplementary.
Speaker, I am disgusted that the Deputy Premier. I am disgusted that the Deputy Premier.
At the clock, please. Order.
I am disgusted that the Deputy Premier would actually raise an issue of a woman who complained about sexual harassment and tried to get me to talk about someone's personal sexual harassment case. That's what that was all about, and shame on you as a Deputy Premier to raise that in this house. Shame on you.
No. It's from all sides. Order, please. Thank you. Finish, please.
Speaker, that not her chief of staff, her campaign director, her Sudbury kingmaker, Sudbury's former riding association president, Andrew Olivier, Glenn Thibault, the OPP, Elections Ontario, or any of the other evidence we've seen.
Mr. Agriculture, come to
order. So can the confidant of the Premier, the Deputy Premier, actually back up the story of the Premier's version of events?
Speaker, I would like to point out that I was not the one who mentioned anything to do with the allegation, other than to say the leader of the third party was asked repeatedly about a matter that was under police investigation, and she repeatedly refused to answer the question because it was under police investigation. It is exactly what they have been subjecting the Premier to week after week. So let me quote again.
It goes both ways. And it's not helpful. It's not helpful when I stand, it continues. Excuse me. Order, please. Order, please. Wrap up, please.
So, let me remind you what the Leader of the Opposition said,
answer.
The Leader of the Third Party said, about a matter that was in front of the police. Right now, this is a matter that's in front of the police. I cannot talk about details because the police aren't...
Thank you. New question. Leader of the Third Party.
Speaker, my next question is for the Deputy Premier. There are taped calls, there are police warrants, there are letters, an independent report from Elections Ontario. They all say that Andrew Olivier was offered a bribe. And instead of answering plain questions, Ontarians get the same response day after day. And yet today, another new low by the Liberals in terms of this discussion. So I ask the Deputy Premier, the Premier's closest confidant, when was the Deputy Premier told, when was she told that there would be no nomination meeting? Was it before or after the bribery attempts?
Thank you. Deputy Premier.
Speaker, I, for one, am delighted that Glenn Debo decided to leave the NDP and join the party. He made a very good decision. And the people of Sudbury made the decision to send him to Queen's Park, Speaker. There are many reasons that they did that. I think that the Northern Life editorial says it best. He's a seasoned politician with deep roots in the community whose skills put him head and shoulders above the other candidates, Speaker. He's been a very effective constituency man, an articulate member for the opposition, and past executive director of United Way. Thibault will be working for the government of power. We believe he'll make a difference. Sudbury is the mining capital of the world. We need to be plugged into government to maximize our economic growth and sustainability.
Thank you.
The people of Sudbury spoke.
Thank you. Supplementary.
Speaker, Ontarians deserve to know who gave the order to offer Andrew Olivier a job. The Liberals have been asked this question 50 times, Speaker, and we have 50 responses, but zero answers. It's not complicated. Who was making the decisions in the Sudbury?
Minister of Economic Development, come to order. Thank you. Deputy Premier.
Well, I know that this will get the Leader of the Third Party angry, but you know what, Speaker? I have to go back and quote her own words back to her. I can't talk about the details at this point because the police are investigating. She was pushed. She was pushed hard 14 times. She was asked the question. And finally, she said, the Premier has not said this, she said, I'm not going to talk about this any longer. I've said to you what I need to say. The police are investigating the matter, and shut down the conversation. Speaker, she knows full well that when an issue is before the police, then it's, then comments are not appropriate.
Answer. Thank you. Final supplementary.
Premier, this is the third week that we've been trying to get answers about the bribery scandal that happened in Sudbury. And instead, Ontarians see the Premier slinging muck, refusing to answer questions. Somebody was making the decisions in the Sudbury bribery scandal, Speaker. The Deputy Premier was aware of the conversations that the Premier had with her soul. Was she aware of any conversations the Premier had with anyone else about a nomination meeting being cancelled in Sudbury?
Deputy Premier.
Well, Speaker, I'm tempted to ask the Leader of the Third Party why she didn't respond to the questions that were asked to her about a criminal investigation, Speaker. I would also like to know, why are they not asking questions about poverty? Why are they not asking questions about homelessness? Why are they not asking questions about insurance? Why are they not asking questions about economic growth? Why are they not asking questions about health care, Speaker? There are many, many issues that on this side of the House we're working hard to address the needs of the people of this province. I think it would be refreshing to have a real policy question instead of another question, Speaker.
New question, member from Nipissing.
Thank you, Speaker. My question is for the acting premier. Just like the gas plant scandal, it's the deputy chief of staff at the centre of OPP allegations. This time, it's allegations in the Sudbury bribery scandal, and it's her words that will be your premier's undoing. The premier stated that she made the decision to appoint the Sudbury candidate in late November. But in December, Pat Sorbera said, quote, "She's," meaning the premier, "gonna," that's a future tense and that's very critical, "she's gonna have to make a decision around the appointment. The tape doesn't lie. On December 12th, she hadn't yet made her decision." Acting premier, will you admit that the premier's version and the version found on the tape are quite different?
Well, Speaker, I appreciate the question, but as I said earlier, I was really, really hoping that the members of the PC caucus would listen to one of their own, the member from Whitby, Oshawa, who said this morning, "For too long, our party has been out of touch with everyday Ontarians." Would we agree? I think we would agree with that. For too long, we've been focused on identifying problems instead of providing solutions. And then she said, and this is what gave me hope, that the member who you, I believe, are supporting for leader said, "Well, that changes today. Today is a new day. Today, all of us here, this team, we have a new attitude and a new plan, and I thought we might see that reflected in question today."
Well, again, to the acting premier, just because she's talking doesn't mean she's answering, Speaker. This is just like the gas plant scandal all over, where Liberal operatives said one thing, but recovered emails, previously deleted, clearly laid out the truth. This time, it's your operatives' words which were caught on tape. Jerry Lougheed went through a hypothetical scenario with Andrew Olivier on December 11th.
Stop the clock. I'm going to continue to ask for decorum, and I will continue to ask all members to race to the top. Finish your question, please.
As if he were Olivier, Lougheed says on the tape, "What are you going to give me to step down? Otherwise, I'm going to sell memberships and see what my chances are." So Mr.
Leader.
Olivier would not be told he could still sell memberships if the decision had already been made in December, like the Premier claims. She's been snared by her own story, which is opposite of the tapes. So, Deputy Premier, will you admit the Premier misled this House?
Same old story.
Member from Prince Edward Hastings, second time. Please withdraw.
Withdraw.
Deputy Premier.
Speaker, I can tell the member opposite that the Premier of this province, the leader of the Ontario Liberal Party, is a woman of enormous integrity. Enormous integrity. She is telling the She is a woman who is building a strong government. She wanted a voice from Sudbury in government, Speaker. She wanted Glenn Thibault on this side of the House working for the people of Sudbury, Speaker. So what she did when she met him in Sudbury, she said, "This is the man I know I want in my caucus," and she decided at that time that he would be the candidate, and then he went on to become the member, Speaker.
The member from Stormont come to order.
The PC
answer.
To deposit, but that's how it goes sometimes. But he was he's a strong candidate, and he is a strong member.
The member from Prince Edward Hastings withdraw.
Withdraw.
No question. The member from Timmins, James Bay.
Integrity? She broke the law, Speaker. I don't see integrity in that. But anyways, my question is to the acting premier. Pat Sorbera and Jerry Lougheed are on tape offering Andrew Olivier anything he wants in order to get out of the way, offering him what the OPP in Election Ontario has described as a bribe. But it doesn't stop there. Pat Sabera told Andrew Olivier that he's the third person the Premier has called in order to push aside a potential candidate. Can the Deputy Premier tell this House who else has the Premier pushed aside and what rewards did the Premier offer them?
Deputy Premier.
Well, Speaker, I hate to go back to Scarborough Guildwood, but I think we have to go back to Scarborough Guildwood. Speaker, you might remember there was a by-election there in 2013. The NDP had a very fine candidate who was wanting the nomination.
Member from Hamilton East, Stony Creek,
a very highly respected person in that community, Speaker, and who was. Who did the leader, the third party, decide she wanted to run there was Adam Giambroni. So instead of having a clean appointment, she chose to run a what I'm not going to say this, but others do, Speaker. The president of the NDP Scarborough Guildwood Riding Association, Paresh Raghubir, said to the Toronto Star, "I'm very disappointed. We are confident that things need to be investigated further. We needed further proof as to what happened in the nomination meeting. Wherever you try to speak about democracy in the party."
Thank you. Supplementary.
It was called a nomination, and Adam Giambrone did the work that you do as a candidate seeking nomination. He got more votes. That is the story. But my question back.
Stop the clock. There are some people I can start with. Thank you. Please finish.
So the Deputy Premier can try to deflect as much as she wants. After offering Andrew Olivier anything he wanted so he'd get out of the way and Glenn Thibault could have an uncontested nomination that the Premier wanted, Pat Sabera told Andrew Olivier, "By the way, you're the third person I've ever heard the Premier ever ask this of. I ask you again, who are those people and what did she offer?"
Deputy Premier.
So let's go back to 2013 Scarborough Guildwood by-election. The candidate Amarjeet Kaur Shabra, Speaker. According to media reports, an independent probe into this nomination was overruled by the Central Party. Leading the president of the NDP Scarborough Guildwood Riding Association to say, and let me repeat, she said, "I am very disappointed. We are confident that things need to be investigated further. We needed further proof as to what happened in the nomination meeting. Whenever you try to speak about democracy in the party, you are demonized." Speaker Paresh Raghubir, the president of the Riding Association, is saying that speaking about democracy makes you demonized in the Ontario New Democratic Party.
Answer. Thank you. Your question, the member from Brampton-Swindle.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. My question is for the Minister of Transportation. Last fall, there were some concerns raised regarding the testing and training of those who drive commercial vehicles. While I understand that safety is our government's number one priority, those living in Brampton-Springdale want to know what measures are in place to ensure that truck drivers are being properly trained. Mr. Speaker, can the Minister of Transportation please confirm whether our government is committed to developing the mandatory truck driver training?
Thank you.
Thanks very much, Mr. Speaker. I want to begin by thanking my colleague, the member from Brampton-Springdale, for the leadership that she's showing in her community, and this is an example of that kind of leadership.
Yeah.
And thank goodness, Speaker, I've got a real question on a transportation issue. Speaker, let me first mention that we've actually seen the number of fatalities involving large trucks and the collisions decline by 41% between 2002 and 2011. This is a remarkable statistic, but we know there's always more that can be done to improve road safety. And that's why both myself and the Minister of Training, Colleges and Universities made a commitment last fall to develop a system that ensures mandatory truck driver training is in place. We've already taken tangible steps towards that goal, Speaker. On February 18th, MTO led the first official consultations on mandatory truck driver training. And on February 25th, I was pleased to attend a roundtable with the Truck Training Schools Association of Ontario. We are committed to moving forward with this mandatory truck driver training, Speaker, and we are putting in the work to make sure it happens.
Thank you.
I want to thank the minister for his response. I'm very happy to hear that our government is committed to developing a mandatory truck driver training regime. Mr. Speaker, the minister mentioned that our government has already taken tangible steps forward on this important issue. Those living in my constituency of Brampton-Springdale would be pleased to hear that our government has been consulting with industry leaders, but I'm certain that they would want to hear more about the details of these consultations. Mr. Speaker, can I ask the minister to please tell members of the House more about the consultations that have been conducted to develop mandatory truck driver training in Ontario?
Thank you. Minister.
Thanks very much, Speaker, and I want to thank the member from Brampton-Springdale for the supplementary. I was very pleased to attend the Truck Training Schools Association of Ontario roundtable last week. Over 100 individuals representing enforcement, municipal, and industry organizations were in attendance at that event. Our government is committed to working together to develop a system that will give Ontarians the confidence to know that commercial drivers are getting the training that they need to succeed on our roads. We will get the best results by hearing directly from those working on the front lines, whether it's carriers, instructors, or insurance providers, and that's why roundtables like the one I attended are so incredibly important. Together, we can and we will deliver a robust program to measure competency and administer mandatory training for commercial truck drivers. We will work to get it right, Speaker,
and
we will find a standard that keeps us at the forefront of road and highway safety in North America. Thanks very much.
New question, the member from Dufferin-Caledon.
Thank you, Speaker. My question is to the Acting Premier. On September 25th, your leader and the Cabinet made a trip to the great city of Sudbury. On that same trip, Jerry Lougheed Jr. hosted a $1,700 and $50 a plate fundraiser for you and your cabinet minister. Was anything promised to Mr. Lougheed in return for his loyalty to the Ontario Liberal Party?
Well, Speaker, you know, I think it's important that the member from Simcoe Gray probably wants to correct his record, Speaker. I have a news release here, a broadcast news from Wednesday, January 28, 1998. It says former NDP Treasurer Floyd Loughran has been appointed to chair the Ontario Energy Board effective March 1st. Energy Minister Jim Wilson made the announcement today. Loughran is the current longest-serving member of Queen's Park.
I listened very carefully, and I truthfully am trying to allow this weaving of in and out. I need to have this woven into an answer.
Mr. Speaker, I'm just wanting the member to correct his record, but I can do that a little bit later, Speaker. The leader of the Ontario Liberal Party, the Premier of Ontario, made a decision to appoint Glenn Thibault to be our candidate in Sudbury by-election. The people of Sudbury endorsed that decision, Speaker, and elected him, and we are delighted that he is he.
Let's get back to the question that was asked. So we all understand the importance of loyalty, but there comes a point when integrity must trump all. Staff and people are loyal because they do exactly what is asked of them. Is that the real reason your leader is so loyal to Pat Sobera and Jerry Lougheed? Because they did exactly what she asked them to do when they spoke to Mr. Olivier on her behalf.
Be seated, please. Thank you.
Speaker, the innuendo and the—I think beneath the dignity of this House that people would impugn the integrity of someone. And I think it's also important to remind people that the police are investigating. So the Premier and others have to leave that investigation to those experts outside this House who are conducting the investigation. I think the member opposite would be interested to know that Mr. Lougheed has also donated
the
to
member for Dufferin-Caledon come to order second time and you ask the question.
Again in 2011.
The member from Dufferin-Caledon is warned. Carry on.
Jerry Lougheed is a very generous person. I think people in Sudbury, I bet even the member from Nickelbelt, would acknowledge that he is a community leader and very generous. And his generosity extends to the Conservative Party with donations to the Conservative Party. I don't think you're looking for anything from him either, Speaker.
Thank you. Question, the member from Bremerly, Gore-Malton.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. My question is to the Acting Premier. Pat Sabir is on tape telling Andrew Olivier that the Premier has pushed aside other people in the past and potentially offered them incentives. Has Pat Sabir been instructed to tell the police who these people are?
Deputy Premier.
Speaker, the member is a lawyer. The member knows what exactly can be said and what cannot be said. The member opposite knows that the police investigation must be conducted outside of this House, Speaker. You know, it's not just the leader of the third party who knows that the police, when a matter's before the police, there are limits to comments you can make. The member also knows, the member from Brampton knows. So when the leader said, I'm not going to talk about this any longer, I've said to you what I need to say. The police are investigating this matter.
Looking for a call,
Speaker,
from Ottawa.
They know that these questions
are Minister of Finance,
and I would welcome a question on auto insurance, Speaker.
Thank you. Supplementary.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I think members in this House know full well that the job of the opposition is to hold the government to account, and that is what we will do. The Premier has pushed aside at least two other people in the past, and she's dealt the same way that she's dealt with these other two people, the same way she's dealt with Mr. Olivier. At least that's what Pat Sabir told Andrew Olivier in the taped phone call message that we have. Has Pat Sabir been told to tell investigators exactly who these people are and what they were offered?
Thank you. Deputy Premier.
Speaker, as I've said many times, this investigation is independent of this government and of this House. We would welcome, we are begging for questions on policy issues that matter to the people of this province. I know there are people here from Leamington. I know they have questions for the Minister of Health. We're begging you, pleading with you, to please ask a substantive question that relates to government policy.
Thank you. New question, member from Newfoundland, Quincy West.
Well, thank you, Speaker. Speaker, my question through you is to the Minister of Agriculture, Food and Rural Affairs.
Great Minister.
Minister, the people in this province are interested in and excited about the government's local food strategy. In my riding, Northumberland, Queenie West, there are great opportunities to support local producers and promote local food, like the Coburg Farmers Market. We know that more consumption of local food is better for our health and supportive for our local agricultural community and economy. I know that through the Local Food Act, our government continues to promote the good things that are grown and harvested across the province. Speaker, would the Minister of Agriculture, Food and Rural Affairs please provide an update and proclamation under the Local Food Act?
Thank you, Minister of Agriculture and Rural Affairs.
Well, thanks very much, Mr. Speaker, and let me tell you, that was an outstanding question for the member of Northumberland, Quinte West.
That's a good one.
A very important policy in terms of local food. We know that buying local food supports our communities. It helps dollars circulate locally, creates jobs, and helps our agri-food sector. That's why we introduced the Local Food Act, and I want to pay tribute to the member from Sarnia-Lambton and the tax credit to donate to local food banks. That's been a great success. And I know the member from Northumberland, Quinte West. He and Diane, they go to the farmer's market in Coburg every Saturday with their grandkids. A great event for them. But, Mr. Speaker, I'm happy to say that a number of our supply management groups are now helping food banks in Ontario. The Chicken Farmers of Ontario has set an annual donation target of 100,000 chickens per year. The Dairy Farmers of Ontario and the Ontario Dairy Council and the Milk Transport Association contribute over 1 million litres of milk every year. And my good friends, the Egg Farmers of Ontario, through a new program, will provide 12,000 dozen eggs.
Thank you. Supplementary.
Well, thank you, Mr. Speaker, and thank you to the Minister for that answer. The food donation tax credit is an integral part of our government's commitment to support farmers, increase access to nutrition, locally grown food and promote the good things that are grown right across the province, Speaker. But Minister, with more local food available, it's important that Ontarians understand how and when they access this great food. Part of the Local Food Act requires governments to set aspirational food literacy goals and targets. Part of the Local Food Act requires will food literacy support local food, it will also promote growth and build opportunities for our agri-food sector.
Question?
Speaker, can the Minister of Agriculture and Rural Affairs please update the House on the status of these targets?
Thank you.
Mr. Speaker, I want to thank the for the supplementary from a good friend, Northumberland Quinty West. And Mr. Speaker, you sense his excitement when he's going to the Coburg Farmers Market every Saturday. This has allowed us to develop a closer relationship, understanding our local food. That's why, under the Local Food Act, we recently announced a set of targets to encourage and increase food literacy across this wonderful province. We want to increase the number of Ontarians who, one, know that local foods are available, two, know how and where to obtain local foods, three, prepare local food meals for family and friends, even meals for the opposition, Mr. Speaker. And new friends, they want to make local food more available through food service providers. We all win, Mr. Speaker, when the food literacy improves. Mr. Speaker, setting these goals is a very exciting step forward, healthy for Ontarians, and see the member at the Coburg Farmers Market this Saturday.
Thank you. Be seated, please. Thank you. I am hanging in, and I am going to ask and remind members that it is not convention to use people's names, and quite frankly, it doesn't elevate the debate, it lowers it. Please refer to members as either their titles or their writings. The member from Bruce Gray Owen Sound.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. My question is to the Deputy Premier. Kerry Lougheed has been described as a kingmaker, as a renowned fundraiser, and as a longtime Liberal Party operative. It's apparent he has the ear of your Premier and her inner circle, and as such, he had the prerogative to offer appointments, jobs, or whatever entitlements to Mr. Olivier. Deputy Premier, outside of this case, and Andrew Olivier not included, has Jerry Lougheed Jr. ever approached any other individual about a legal appointment on behalf of the Premier?
Member from Beaches, East York, second time. Thank you. Deputy Premier.
Well, Speaker, as I said earlier, Jerry Lougheed Jr. is an outstanding member of the Sudbury community. He is extraordinarily generous personally, and he's also spearheaded fundraising campaigns for many causes, including the hospital there, Speaker. Even the member from Timmins Jane Bay says he's a great guy. So, Speaker, you know, I just do want to go back to the situation when Floyd Loughran resigned his seat to become chair of the Ontario Energy Board. We heard from the former Minister of Energy, the member from Simcoe Gray, that he resigned his seat before he was appointed, and actually history does not bear that out. This news release I started to read said that he's been appointed chair effective March 1st. Jim Wilson made the announcement today. He's expected to announce his resignation from the legislature later today in Sudbury. So I'm sure the member opposite will want to correct his record.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. Again to the Deputy Premier. There is no doubt Jerry Lougheed Jr. is well connected in Sudbury. That fact stands. And as the Deputy Premier just said, Mr. Lougheed felt he's very generous, but not with provincial appointments, Mr. Speaker. He felt he could make calls to individuals on behalf of the Premier. There's no indication the Premier herself did or said anything to stop or deny him that entitlement. So, separate from this ongoing bribery investigation case, has the Premier ever before acted on the recommendation of friend Jerry Lougheed Jr. in appointing individuals to one of the province's agencies, boards, or commissions?
Well, Speaker, as I said before, Jerry Lougheed Jr. is an outstanding member of the community in Sudbury, and he has been supportive not just of the Liberal Party, but the Conservative Party as well, Speaker. So, you know, I do want to go back to the question of of who's going to step down for Patrick Brown. Because there is a history, you know, of members resigning their seats for a new leader. David Tilson.
As I've tried to indicate to members on a constant basis, I am truly trying to listen carefully to all of the responses and all of the questions. I'm also going to indicate to you that it does get bothersome and some tiresome that people are trying to tell me how to do the job. And most of all, for the sake of all of you, I think we need to move the level up. And for me to hear, I'm hearing these interjections on an ongoing basis, back and forth, even when persons are trying to ask and put the question. You're not helping me at all, and I wouldn't mind your help. I'm going to ask the member to, again, focus on the answer. Thank you.
Well, Speaker, this is an issue that has been discussed to the exclusion of every other issue in the province of Ontario for the past 3 weeks. I find it interesting that the member opposite isn't asking about his hospital in Markdale. I'm surprised he isn't asking for an update on that terrific announcement that the Minister of Health made, an issue that affects every person in his community, Speaker.
Thank you. No question. The member from Kitchener-Waterloo.
Thank you very much. My question is to the Deputy Premier. The Liberal government is now facing four OPP anti-racket branch investigations. Does the Deputy Premier think that this is acceptable for the people of this province?
Deputy Premier.
Well, Speaker, you know, as my colleague, the member from Ottawa Centre, has said, it's hard when you get two black eyes. You get one black eye because a member of your party has crossed to another party, and it's another black eye, and that hurts when you lose a seat that you hold, Speaker. So, you know, we actually have had this experience ourselves. We know it hurts when you lose a seat, but two black eyes, we understand, are hard to take. The people of Sudbury have spoken. The people of Sudbury had access to those tapes that were on Facebook and YouTube, Speaker, through the campaign. The people of Sudbury chose Glenn Thibeault. Northern Life had a, I think, very illuminating editorial on February 2nd. They said, we say, elect Glenn Thibeault. He's a seasoned politician with deep roots in the community.
Answer.
Whose skills put him head and shoulders above the other candidates. People, or Speaker, the people of Sudbury have spoken, and we're glad they did.
Supplementary.
Again to the Deputy Premier. You will remember that the police investigated Rob Ford for Project Traveller and for Project Brazen 2. This Premier is now facing twice as many police investigations as Rob Ford. Speaker, more is not better in this regard. And now the Liberals have hired Rob Ford's chief of staff because maybe they're hoping he knows a thing or two about politicians and their trusted insiders facing down the police. Is the Deputy Premier proud that the Liberal government has one-upped Rob Ford when it comes to police investigations?
Deputy Premier.
Well, Speaker, I'm delighted that the member has weighed in on this, and I sure would be interested in knowing her story about her nomination when she decided to run for the NDP, Speaker. All of us have stories about our nominations. On our side of the House, we have to fight for our nominations. I actually had a contested nomination in 2003. Many of us had contested nominations. I'm not sure what the NDP Constitution has to say about appointments, but I do understand they do not allow appointments, but they have other ways of ensuring certain candidates do get uncontested nominations, Speaker. So there is a certain degree of hypocrisy that's being expressed in this House, Speaker.
The member will withdraw.
I withdraw.
New question. The member from Trinity Spadina.
Hey, good question.
Speaker, my question is for the Attorney General. Mr. Speaker, upholding and ensuring equal access to the justice system is a very important element to the people and the province of Ontario.
Absolutely.
After Minister Mandate letter were made public prior to the last session, I noticed that ensuring access to justice was a priority for the Office of Attorney General. A number of constituents in Trinity Spadina have been reading in the news about a bill she introduced in the past session. The Protection of Public Participation Act generated a positive response from the member of the legal community. In that, it addressed the issue of equal access to justice and ensured the equality of justice system. I'm personally curious to know as to how this bill accomplished this very difficult task. Mr. Speaker, through you to the Attorney General, could she please elaborate on how Bill 52 ensures access to justice for every member of this
Council? Answer. Question, sorry. Attorney General.
Thank you, Mr. President. Mr. Speaker, I want to thank the member from Trinity Spadina. He brings a very, very important question, and he's a great representative of his riding, and we welcome him to Queen's Park. The Protection of Public Participation Act is a very important step ensuring access to justice because it aims to eliminate what are called strategic lawsuits. These types of lawsuits are designed to silence public participation rather than being based on legitimate concern. Using intimidation tactic to silence one's opponent is a misuse of our court system, one of the central institutions of a fair and democratic society. By protecting citizens against strategic legislation, our government is protecting the rights of Ontario residents to speak out on matters that are important to us. Merci, Mr. Speaker.
Thank you. Supplementary.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, I thank the Attorney General for informing this House on how Bill 52 is working for Ontarians in keeping the justice system open, accessible, and democratic. It is great to hear this process has made in this area. Progress has been made in this area. My constituents and I were very disappointed when a similar piece of legislation, Bill 83, died on order paper when the last general election was called. However, I would appreciate if the Attorney General could clarify some of the details within the bill itself. Mr. Speaker, through you to the Attorney General, could she please elaborate on what a strategic lawsuit is and clarify how this bill will work if it were to be passed in this legislature?
Thank you, Attorney General.
Yes, merci, Monsieur Speaker, and I want to thank again the member from Trinity Spadina. You know, on this side of the House, we're not used to have a member from Trinity Spadina, so welcome again. And I want to thank him for his question, as the definition of a strategic lawsuit can be difficult to understand. Strategic lawsuits are launched to silence potential critics rather than to obtain a remedy for harm done by a particular criticism. This can come in a form of financial intimidation by threatening a long, often expensive lawsuit that ultimately silences an individual or group's opinion. This legislation balances the protection of public participation and freedom of expression against the protection of reputation and economic interest. Mr. Speaker, this bill was debated this morning in the House, and I can sense that there is the support of the two parties. So let's get the bill to committee. Thank you, Mr. Speaker.
Question, the member from Oxford.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, my question is to the Acting Premier. Acting Premier, I've had the privilege of serving in this legislature for many years. I've served with many honourable members, members who didn't wait to step aside when their integrity was being called into question. The Premier said Sobrera and Lougheed didn't offer their resignations. A lot of time has passed since then. Acting Premier, at any time since the scandal broke, has either Sobrera or Lougheed offered their resignation?
Deputy Premier.
Well, Speaker, again, for a moment I thought the member wanted to talk about the new hospital in Woodstock, but I understand that any issues of policy are not being permitted by your head office there. But what I can tell you, Speaker, is that this investigation is independent of government. This investigation is independent of this House, Speaker. The investigation is underway. There is full cooperation with the investigation, and we take it very seriously and are cooperating fully. I want to remind the member what the Chief Electoral Officer clearly stated. He said, "I am neither deciding to prosecute a matter nor determining anyone's guilt or innocence. These decisions are respectively for prosecutors and judges, Speaker." So I welcome the question. I do think, though, that the people of Oxford County have other questions they'd like their member to be asking.
Parliamentary.
Well, again, my question is to the Acting Premier. And Acting Premier, I want to say the reason I asked this question is because I wanted this question answered. The evidence is continuing to mount against Ms. Sobrera and Jerry Lougheed. When I served in government, our staff was held accountable. They knew when they were in the wrong, they were going to have to pay the price.
Thank you.
Acting Premier, is your government culture so arrogant your staff knows they can avoid accountability?
It is. Thank you. Stop the clock, please. Proceed, please. Proceed, please. Thank you. Deputy Premier.
Thank you. Our Premier demands the highest level of ethics and accountability of her staff and of her caucus, Speaker. The attacks on the Premier are, I think, unseemly, Speaker. There is an investigation underway. The Premier has been extremely forthcoming about what she said, to the extent that she released a statement that she had written 3 weeks ago, Speaker. She's been very clear about her position. She's been very clear that she will cooperate fully with the investigation, Speaker. But again, I say, is this really the only question that people in Ontario want asked in this House?
Thank you. New question. The member from Algoma, Manitouma.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Good morning to you. My question is pretty simple, and it's to the minister. Pat Sobrera, Jerry Lougheed, Andrew Olivier, Glenn Thibault, the OPP, Elections Ontario, all have a version of the Sudbury bribery scandal. The Premier has another. Who is telling the truth?
Thank you. Deputy Premier.
Speaker, the Premier is telling the truth. Now, we have now, this marks the last opposition question, another week in the Ontario Legislature, another week where no questions of substance were asked by any of the members of the opposition, Speaker. We have people from Leamington who are here today because they want answers to questions. But this question period has, like all others, has not addressed the questions of people who come to the legislature. They've come from Leamington to be here to get questions from the Minister of Health. I don't understand why local members are not asking questions that are important to their constituents. I don't understand why groups are not asking questions that relate to the area that they are criticizing. Speaker,
answer.
We will continue to answer questions, but we will continue to answer the questions with the same answers we've been giving for 3 weeks.
Thank you. Supplementary.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Again, to the Deputy Minister, I'll take it a step slower. The Premier says she made an appointment in November. The Premier's own letter, her campaign director, her kingmaker, her former candidate, the riding association, all say, nope, no decision. Not everyone can be right. Who is telling the truth?
Thank you, Deputy Premier.
Speaker, the question that the member, is asking is when did the Premier communicate her decision? She has been very clear that she made the decision to appoint have Glenn Thibault as our candidate when she met him, Speaker. She was very clear about she wanted him to be the candidate, and so did the people of Sudbury. But Speaker, if the opposition won't ask the question, let me answer what's happening at the at Leamington, Speaker, the obstetrics at Leamington. An expert panel was convened to closely examine the issue.
Thank you, but to the question.
All right. Nice try.
So, Speaker, I know the member is not from Leamington.
Answer.
He's not the member. From Leamington.
Thank you. New question, the member from Kingston and the Isles.
Mr. Speaker, my question is for the Minister of Northern Development and Mines. As many of you know, the annual Prospectors and Developers Convention just wrapped up in Toronto yesterday. We are certainly proud that Ontario is home to this world-renowned event for the mineral industry. After not going for many years personally, I was pleased to join the Premier and the Minister of Northern Development and Mines, along with several caucus members, at the Ontario reception earlier this week. The reception welcomed hundreds of municipal, First Nations, industry representatives and students, all with a keen interest in Ontario's mineral development industry. In fact, all members should consider attending. Mr. Speaker, our province is blessed with an array of natural resources. Can the minister please share the recent investments our government has made in the Ring of Fire?
Minister of Northern Development.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. I want to thank the member for Kingston and the Islands for the question. Just wonderful to see her and so many other caucus members at the Ontario government reception. And PDAC was indeed a tremendous success. It gave our government the right platform to discuss the many exciting investment opportunities in the mining sector in the province. And Mr. Speaker, after Premier Wynne and Prime Minister Harper met earlier in January, I got the chance to go to Ottawa to meet with federal Natural Resources Minister Rickford, and it was at that meeting that we discussed very precise opportunities for collaboration on and progress in the Ring of Fire. And at PDAC this past week, the first very strong fruits of that labor were us being able to jointly announce more than $750,000 to support economic development, community access for a number of communities in the region. Just a great announcement.
Thank you. Supplementary.
Mr. Speaker, I would like to thank the minister for his response. I agree with the minister. It was clear to me that there is a keen interest in our province's mineral sector. Monsieur President,
it is clear that the Ring of Fire is a very interesting at the national level. It's also something that has interest around the world.
Development create thousands of jobs and significantly strengthen our province's economy for many years to come. I was particularly pleased to see so many First Nations representatives attending the conference, something I do not recall when I visited in past years. We are also glad to see the federal government taking steps to become engaged with the Ring of Fire with us.
Question?
Mr. Speaker, can the minister please share how this joint investment will help to foster private sector investment and sustainable development in the Ring of Fire?
Thank you.
Thanks again, Speaker, and indeed it was very, very good to be able to see a matching investment from the federal government for this particular variance special project. And obviously, we're looking forward to seeing far more significant investments matching our great support. This is a really great project. The investment we made and we're sharing with the federal government is for the Wabukwe First Nation in partnership with Ibamatun, Nishkandaga, and the Binimik First Nations to complete a regional community service corridor study. This is really important in terms of moving all the infrastructure needs forward in the Ring of Fire. It builds on the progress that we've made on what I've spoken about often, the historic regional framework agreement that we signed with Mattawa First Nations. This lays the groundwork, Mr. Speaker, for First Nations to come together to explore options for a community service corridor that will lead to multi-generational benefits associated with resource development in the region. Thank you very much.
Renfrew, Nipissing, Pembroke, on a point of order.
Thank you very much, Speaker. And earlier, and I recognize your interjection there, and I apologize if you saw this the wrong way, but at no time would I ever imply that I was here to do your job. I wouldn't be able to do a very good job if you're doing a wonderful job, Speaker. But I want to point out, Speaker, that in this House it is the tradition that points of order won't be recognized during oral questions. So our only opportunity is sometimes to interject, and sometimes we get chastised for it, and sometimes we certainly deserve it. But I do want to point out that on numerous occasions today, the Deputy Premier alluded to something that has not happened, may never happen, has nothing to do with the questions at hand, and asking members of the opposition if they're going to resign their seats. That, in fact, is an inappropriate way of dealing with the matters in this House. You should not be implying that members on this side of the House are intending to resign their seats. And she's implying that, and I believe it to be absolutely inappropriate and wrong.
I thank the member for his point of order. He has a point of order that does ask about the direction of question and answer period, which is absolutely legitimate. The one thing I would say to him that it may or may not be appropriate, but it's not out of order. And the difference between the two is the fact that I have guided in today's question period some people to come back to the to answering the question. So I thank the member for his point of order. The member from Lanark, Frontenac, Lennox and Addington on a point of order.
Thank you, Speaker. I'd like to just correct the record. Earlier during question period, I made reference to the great theatrical performance. I forgot to include it was the Minister of Agriculture, Food and Rural Affairs.
Well, it's not a point of order. There are no deferred votes. This House stands adjourned until 1 p.m. this afternoon.